Greetings to the one who is watching this video. The idea of this video is to introduce you to the mathematics for machine learning, and this will be a long playlist of videos where we will cover this book. I will share the link to this book. It's a free book available online, and that is a very great initiative to understand the mathematics behind machine learning. The authors of this book have tried really hard in order to illustrate all the concepts, or I should say most of the concepts which are used in machine learning, but there are some things which would require an instructor to really come in between to understand some of the basic ideas of this book so that this book is accessible to all. So I'm trying to be one such person, and let's see how this goes. Okay, so the first chapter is on linear algebra, and okay, let's go through what the book says, and I'll try to summarize so that when you go and self-study, things will be much more easier for you. Okay, so moving on. So we have tried to formalize the concept of a vector. Okay, so what makes something a vector? Okay, let's consider that we have two variables, okay, x and y, which belong to some set, let's say S. Okay, this is the case, and let's define that whenever we add these two variables, their result, which let's say is z, it also belongs to S. Okay, now consider one more operation. Okay, take a number lambda and multiply it with an element of S. Okay, and let's define that this also belongs to the set S for all lambda in the set of real number. Okay, now we say that objects, or you could say variables, which satisfy these two properties are vectors. Okay, so this book gives you some examples of such objects which satisfy this property. Okay, now let's look at the geometric vectors, which are the vectors which we usually are exposed to in the beginning. Okay, so these vectors are nothing but directed line segments, and we can add these two vectors, and it is a vector in the same two dimensional space. Okay, so this time our set S will be consisting of these directed line segments in a two-dimensional plane. Okay, and we will be able to define the addition operation. So a typical vector addition operation is a parallelogram law of addition, and we know that if this vector is x, this vector is y, we obviously know that x plus y equals this vector. Okay, now similarly, when we multiply a vector with some value lambda, right? So we have a simple vector x. When we multiply it with, let's say, 2, it becomes a vector 2 times x. Basically, its direction doesn't change when it is multiplied by a positive number. And also, we see that its length gets extended by the factor of 2. Okay, so we see that the scaling operation is basically constructing another vector in the same direction, but its magnitude is scaled by that scaling factor. But also, yeah, as you can as you all already might be knowing, that the if the scalar is a negative number, let's say negative of 2x, this vector becomes this, that is in the opposite direction. And yeah, so you could say that the scaling operation either keeps a vector in the same direction, or it inverts the direction, 180 degree turn. Okay, but the magnitude is always scaled by the absolute value of the scaling number, which is any real number, okay, for that matter. So this is one example of a vector, and I have explored this in I hope in decent depth, so that you can get an idea how these geometric vectors are satisfying the property of a general vector, which I defined above. That is, when we add two vectors, we get a vector, another vector, and when we multiply it with any real value, it is still a vector in two-dimensional space. Okay, now moving on, we see that whenever we consider a polynomial right like this, right, 2x square plus 3x plus 5, for example, okay, this is some general quadratic polynomial, and let's say we have another polynomial, okay, 4x square minus 6x plus 7, okay. If you look at it carefully, okay, when we add these two polynomials, we see that their sum is also another polynomial, right? So adding two polynomials, okay, they can be of any degree, but let's consider quadratic polynomial. Adding two polynomials leads to a polynomial, okay? And when we scale it by some real number, let's say 3, this will make another polynomial, right? 6x square plus 9x plus 15. So again, a polynomial satisfies both these properties. But yeah, it's very counterintuitive because we already know how a geometric vector looks like, right? But here, a polynomial is also a vector because the first thing that we considered is the closure of addition, that is, when we add two objects from the same set, it leads to a value which is a part of the same set, and a scalar multiplication also generates another element from the same set. So we have to satisfy these two properties, and we can clearly see that polynomials also satisfy these properties, and we can classify them as vectors. And you can see that you cannot really make a polynomial addition. It's just random graphs, and you cannot really have a method to add graphs. Like, you cannot say that this orange graph plus this green graph is equal to some red graph. Okay, there's no way of knowing that because graphs can be randomly shaped, and there is no such clear-cut way that we had in geometric vectors to be able to really visualize addition and scalar multiplication in a very visually understandable way. Okay, so these were the two examples of vectors that we kind of understand when we are understanding the general concept of a vector. Okay, now the third example is I would say that it's not really important if you're not into signal processing and all those topics, but I would try to make this idea very simple and easy to understand what it is trying to mean. Okay, so let's consider that you have you could say a list of numbers. Okay, so let's say the intensity of sound was 22 in the first second, then we measured the intensity of sound in the second 23, and let's say it varied like this over time. Okay, so and so on, so on. So you could see that this is the intensity of sound in the first second, in the second second, in the third second, and so on and so forth. So if you have another such element, then you can add those values and see that, okay, if you add it component by component, that is the intensity of sound at the first second, individual values if you add, you will see that it will also lead to another similar list where each element of the two vectors will be nothing but the sum of the individual elements, right? So it's also a vector. I mean, not very important, but since they have mentioned it, let's understand it. Okay, fine. But we reach the most famous way of representing vectors that we will see throughout this book, and that is this particular way of representing vector as a column. Okay, so when we see vectors represented like this, and in this example it has three elements, okay, 1, 2, and 3, so we say that A belongs to vectors in three dimension. You could say that the dimension is the number of components. Okay, so for now you can understand it as the number of components, but things can get really complicated towards the future, but for now this is the case. Okay, number of components, it has three components. Okay, similarly, a vector, if I write a vector b equals 1 minus 1 2 1, then it belongs to the this set, fourth dimensional vector. Okay, this is a 4D vector. Okay, now we say that elements of R to the n, right, the tuple of n real numbers, are vectors. Okay, because if we define component wise addition, right, so let's consider 2D vectors for now, and we add them this way. Okay, we define the addition between two vectors as the component wise addition of their elements. Okay, so the first element of this result will be 4, and the second component will be 6, because 1 plus 3 is equal to 4 and 2 plus 4 is equal to 6, and this is also a vector which looks like that it belongs to a 2D vector, okay, two dimensional vector. Okay, now we see that the sum is a vector in two dimension, and similarly we can scale it by some lambda value and we will get lambda and 2 lambda. Okay, so we have defined the scalar operation in this way, that whenever we multiply it by a scalar, each individual entry in the vector gets scaled by that, gets multiplied with that real number lambda. So we see that this is also a two dimensional vector, right? So we know that tuples, that is, okay, for now, okay, so generally tuples are represented like this, okay, 1, 2, and 3, but in order to make the math easy to understand, we will represent vectors like this, okay, as a column. So this has 3 rows and 1 column. Okay, I am repeating the word column and again and again, because in the matrix terminology, in the terminology of linear algebra, a matrix, you could say a rectangular array of numbers which has only one column is called a column vector. Okay, so that's why I'm calling it column again and again. Okay, so as you can see, they have mentioned that it satisfies the two properties of a general vector, and that's why it's called a vector. Okay, so we will study objects like these and how they are useful in machine learning in the future. Okay, so next time we will move to this particular topic. Okay, so systems of linear equations. But before ending the video, I would like to tell you that you could look at these graph, or you could look at this flow chart to understand how concepts in this chapter are related to other parts of the book. But I would recommend that don't try to understand this thing too much on your first read, because there are too many terms that you might not be knowing, and it's best if you explore this book like without even looking at this. Okay, so that's it for this lecture. I hope you liked the video, and if you would like to support us, give us a like, and that would be really good. So thank you.